You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
And a good Tuesday evening to all of you out there in television land. Welcome to session number 14, our final session of the fall semester 2013. You've tuned in once again, and regretfully for the last time, you've tuned in to IDS 336. This is Jazz in the Modern Era. I'm Chet Hanley, and as always, we are coming to you live from the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills, over LA 30. You know the mantra, LA 36 and all of its local affiliates. And we are also coming to you via the internet, so we are worldwide. As those numbers scroll before your very eyes for the last time, unfortunately, you know them all at this point in time. We'll be on the air through 10 p.m. this evening, and I invite your calls. There's our number into our little room here on campus. You notice the different background, folks? Stay tuned. 800-339-1193 is our number. And a reminder that all of our broadcasts are archived on YouTube. Everything's on YouTube these days. YouTube.com/CSUDHTV. And for those of you who would like to communicate via that little computer in your pocket or your desktop, there's your address if you want to send us a text. Be happy to answer questions. Give us a call or send us a text. Let us know you're out there. We kick things off for our final session with one of the great giants, and one of the great giants who unfortunately left us a little better than a week ago, the great Chico Hamilton. This is his band from 1962. The name of the tune, very simply, Passing Through. And that's the title track from, again, 1962. And one of the great Chico Hamilton quintets. He had several, and this one included the great George Bohannon on trombone, Charles Lloyd, who wrote that tune, on tenor saxophone, Albert Stenson on bass, and of course on guitar. I mean, nobody sounded like the guitarist that worked with Chico Hamilton and with Charles Lloyd for a number of years, the great Gabor Szabo. Again, from 1962, Passing Through, Chico Hamilton. We have so much more to share with you regarding the life of the late, great Chico Hamilton. Also have some more very, very special surprises. If you've been with me throughout, you know that some wonderful people are going to join us for our last session. I'm looking forward to that opportunity. We're going to carry on now. We've already established a groove. We're going to continue a different kind of groove for you for our last broadcast. We're going to feature a duo in concert at Blues Alley in Washington, D.C., the stylings of the one, the only, Mr. Max Roach, working with his bassist at that time in the early 1980s, Mr. Calvin Hill. They're going to do a little tune, and what an appropriate title for this tune. I think you'll understand what I mean when you hear it. The tune, Back to Basics, Max Roach and Calvin Hill. Thank you. Now that you're in a groove, we can carry on. That goes back to 1981, Blues Alley in Washington, D.C., the Max Roach Unit. In this case, this was Max Roach and Calvin Hill working in duo fashion on a tune very simply entitled Back to Basics. Of course, Max Roach, one of the greats of all time, one of the innovators at the kit, and his bassist at the time, Mr. Calvin Hill. Good stuff. For a Tuesday evening from Cal State Dominguez Hills, in our little room here. You noticed, ladies and gentlemen, those of you who are regulars, as well as those of you enrolled, you noticed that the backdrop is a little different. If you've watched over the course of the semester and in past years, you know that this generally is where the musicians perform. Well, do not expect me to get up and play anything, any saxophone or trumpet or whatever. No, we decided we're going to change up a little bit for our last broadcast and have a little fun. I want to do this before I go any further. Two very, very special people have joined me this evening, and it is truly my pleasure to invite back for the a little bit of time that we've been doing this. He has a standing invitation to join me each and every semester because he brings so much information to the table here with regard to this music that we've been sharing with you over the last 14 weeks. He is involved in so many organizations related to jazz. He continues to MC events. He is truly an historian. He knows, as you know, for those of you who watched us before, he knows more about this music than I'll ever know in my lifetime. And again, it's always a pleasure. Each and every semester, he brings a different theme out. We're gonna explore a theme, but more specifically, we're gonna take a look at an important organization. But before I go any further, my friend Jeffrey Winston has joined us once again. Jeffrey?
Chad, always a pleasure.
It's my pleasure indeed.
Put a lot of pressure on
you. Oh, hey, no pressure at all. And to Jeffrey's left is a very, very special lady who has been involved in the music for a number of years in her own very, very unique and special way. Miss Edith Bronston, attorney at law, who just happens to be the president of a very, very important organization that connects to this music. And she's involved in so many activities that connect with that organization, as well as just very simply being a jazz aficionado. Stay tuned. Without further ado, Miss Edith Bronston. Edie, welcome.
Thanks for having me. Oh, it's a pleasure.
It's my pleasure indeed. The California Jazz Foundation, you are the president. Jeff is a board member and still the secretary, Jeff?
Yes.
Yeah, still taking those notes. All right. Edith, for those of viewers who may not know about the California Jazz Foundation, give us some basics. Talk about the basics of that foundation.
Well, we were formed in January of 2006 around my dining room table. We didn't have a dime, but we had a whole bunch of like-minded people who love jazz musicians, and really were aware of their plight, which is pretty tragic. Because as I always tell people, you know, jazz musicians are wonderful people and they have an innocent outlook. And as long as they can play, they don't internalize the possibility that they ever might not be able to play. And on the one hand, that's really great because what you see is what you get, and it's a wonderful thing. There are no hidden agendas. They're very childlike in some ways.
And you know what? Aren't we all in some respects?
Well, one hopes.
But one hopes.
But hopefully those of us who can make a difference understand that they do have to internalize it. Someday they may not be able to work, whether it's from illness and accident, the clubs closing, what's happening with the marketing of music, age. So many jazz musicians have significant others who had them on their insurance. And you know what happened in 2008? Older people got laid off.
Right.
And nobody can afford COBRA. Nobody.
Amen.
I don't care how wealthy you are. You can't afford COBRA. So everybody is losing their coverage. Hopefully with Obamacare, that's going to change. I certainly hope
so. Keep our fingers crossed. As long as they get the technology straightened out.
We all are. Well, I think they will. Mm-hmm. I can't imagine that they won't. But
and if we can maybe get the other side to see the light with regard to affordable health care. So what you're saying, Edith, essentially, is that musicians are people, too. And they have the same issues that we all have with regard to health care and looking beyond the bandstand. And some are able to, or have been able to, recognize what's beyond the bandstand and prepare for that. But there are others who play the music and play it as well as anybody, but haven't done that kind of planning, that long-range planning, to see them through the rest of their existence. Huh?
It's been my experience that very few are in the latter category, unfortunately.
Yeah, yeah.
And the young musicians, I mean, they can get sick, too.
That's right.
They can have an accident and, oh, my God, something that they wouldn't even have considered for another 40 years hits them in the face. And, you know, the other thing is that there are safety nets as far as health care is concerned. There's Medicaid. Mm-hmm. There are food stamps. There's this and that. But that doesn't pay the rent. It doesn't pay the rent, and it doesn't really put food on the table for their families. And that's where we come in. You know, we've now helped 134 musicians.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
You know, we'd like to do a whole lot more. We help as many as we can.
Yeah.
It's difficult getting people to apply.
Yeah.
You know, by the time people realize how bad things are, if they're bad, they're operating at overwhelm, An application is daunting, but we belong to the, Jeffrey, help me here, I always forget what it's called, the coordination, the Entertainment Assistance Cooperative, it's a mouthful, EAC, and it is all of the Southern California Entertainment Assistance agencies. Mm-hmm. And they meet every 2 months, and all of our social workers get together, either by phone or in person, so that whoever opens a file for a musician will actually call the other social workers and will say, the California Jazz Foundation was able to help with rent for February. Mm-hmm. Can you, Music Cares, or you, the Actors Fund, or you, whomever, Society of Singers, can you help with March? Or can you help with the utilities? Or can you help with the cell phone service? You know, without a cell phone, they can't work.
It's tough. Yeah,
yeah.
Trying to make the gig.
Without.
I want to come back and talk more about the foundation in a moment. Jeffrey, I know that you've been involved with the California Jazz Foundation now for a number of years. Were you there at the beginning? That I'm not clear.
After about the first 6 months.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We were in Glendale, and we were going to hear Tootie Heath and some other musicians, and she approached me at the table.
Ah, okay.
And that's how it all started.
Wow, okay. And the rest is history.
Right.
Well, we had been talking
right. For
several months about Earl Palmer
without
ever having met. Mm. And we recognized each other's voices at the table that night.
Gotcha. I want to come back in just a moment and talk a little bit about how those like-minded people came together back in 2006. But I have it on good authority, Edith Bronston, that you like good jazz.
I like good jazz.
And I know for a fact that you are buddies with this next artist that we're going to feature in concert. We go back to 89. This was recorded for a television station in San Diego as part of their Club Date series, specifically Terry Gibbs. That's who we're talking about. In this case, he's working with Buddy DeFranco. They're going to do a little Horace Silver Line, and then we'll come back. Thank you. 1989, this was broadcast on KPBS television in San Diego as part of their Club Date series. If you've been with me over the years, I probably shared some footage of the great Buddy Collette doing a Club Date session as well. But in this case, it's Terry Gibbs, the wonderful vibraphonist, one of the best of all time working with a true clarinet master, Mr. Buddy DeFranco. And you know the tune, Horace Silver's Sister Sadie. The cats, Terry Gibbs again on vibraphone, Buddy DeFranco on clarinet, Robert Hamilton at the piano. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, that was Chris Conner. Those of you who are aficionados, you're saying, I know that face somewhere. That was Chris Conner on bass. And Jerry Gibbs on drums. Of course, Jerry Gibbs, Terry Gibbs' son. My very special guest who joined me, Mr. Jeffrey Winston, who joins me each and every semester. And like I said, he always has a standing invitation to join us. And visiting us for the first time is Edith. Can I call you Edie?
Please.
Edie Bronston, who just happens to be, among other things.
She's the bebop barrister.
The bebop barrister. Thanks, Jeff. The president of the California Jazz Foundation, and we're talking about that foundation. First of all, Terry Gibbs. Terry and Jerry, talk about those cats, Edith.
Well, gosh. I met Terry Gibbs the day that he got the LA Jazz Society Vibe Summit Award.
Yeah.
And I was with Freddie Gruber. I think it was our second date. And he introduced me to Jerry, to Terry, who said, what are you doing with that crazy person? And that was the start of our relationship.
By the way, let me jump in for those who may not know. Freddie Gruber was a very, very special musician, one of the great drummers of all time. A lot of people don't know that name, but a year ago, Jeff, mm-hmm. Jeffrey and I did a profile of the great Freddie Gruber, drummer supreme and teacher, master teacher of the Kit Supreme as well. So I just thought I'd let you know that. Go ahead, Edith.
Well, Freddie and I had a 15-year relationship. He died 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I met a gazillion people, wonderful people through him, and one of them was Terry, and we've become very close.
Great.
And Jerry and I have become very close. Freddie just thought Jerry was a wonderful drummer. And Jerry comes every New Year's Eve. He'll be here at my house New Year's Eve. He does my music. So it's quite wonderful. People put up with no parking at my house because the parties and the music are wonderful. And mm-hmm. Jeffrey's usually there. Mm-hmm. And I hope you'll join us.
Oh, I gotta make it a point.
Yeah.
Make it a point.
Yeah.
The California Jazz Foundation. How is it that like-minded people, as you mentioned, as you alluded to earlier, came together with the purpose of establishing this organization?
I had given money for several years to the Jazz Foundation of America. Not a lot of money, but I gave often. And I just assumed that everybody in California knew about it, and I was quite flabbergasted to learn that the musicians didn't know about it, my friends who were jazz lovers didn't know about it.
Yeah.
So I called the executive director in New York of the Jazz Foundation of America, and I said, this is who I am. I'm a lawyer, I'm a jazz lover, and I'm really good at starting things. And I'd really like to start a West Coast chapter of the Jazz Foundation of America. And I went back to New York, and I met with the executive director and the social workers, and I was supposed to make a presentation to their board, and it never happened.
Mm-hmm.
And they weren't, it just never happened. I don't want to go into it. But I came back and I said, okay, we're going to have to do it ourselves. And I didn't know the first thing about starting a nonprofit.
How long had they been?
The Jazz Foundation of America?
Yes.
Oh, it was about 17 years at the time.
Okay.
Yeah, they've been around a long time,
but
they're a little bit different than we are. But they struggled. We all struggle. All the nonprofits struggle.
Indeed.
Yeah, especially under the last few administrations, we've struggled. But what do you do when you start a nonprofit? You gather together your friends and the people who are like-minded. You know, so Jimmy Allen was one of the first people who joined us, and he introduced me to Dr. Joe Kahn, and they were my first two board members. And then 6 months down the road, I met Jeffrey, mm-hmm. and we meet in my dining room, around my dining room table. We didn't have a dime, not a dime, and you know we had to start. And we weren't a nonprofit yet because you have to get a tax-exempt letter from the IRS.
Yeah.
And then I was on the jazz cruise. And I heard, I was talking up what we were doing, mm-hmm. and I heard about a musician in San Francisco who had had back surgery and who was recovering very nicely, but he couldn't play. Which brought it home to me. Oh my God, the guy is doing fine. He plays all the time in San Francisco. Mm. He makes an okay living, but he's in
as a musician,
mm-hmm. but he's 70 some years old, mm-hmm. and he can't put food on the table, and he can't pay his rent because he can't play.
Gotcha.
And so we didn't have any money, so we passed the hat and. You know, we sent them a check.
Wow.
That we paid his rent. We don't ever pay musicians. We pay third parties.
Gotcha. Okay.
That's what they taught me. The social workers taught me in New York when I met with them. And
was that as a result of experience, or did
the
larger organization said this is the route you should take?
No, they said that, but it was because of experience.
Okay.
Yes. They said you never, ever, ever. You want to make sure that the money goes to the creditor, to mm-hmm. the landlord, mm-hmm. to the grocery store,
yeah.
to the gas station.
Get
you
those
know.
Bills paid immediately.
Yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm. yes. Okay. And that's what we've always done. So I was very fortunate. I work with a lawyer, Dominic Lobulio, who agreed to be our CFO. Of course, he had never worked with a nonprofit before either. So we learned as we went, and we got our papers filed.
Yeah.
And our first event was at the Union at Local 47, and we sweated bullets because we didn't have our letter yet. And I got both Dianne Feinstein and Barbara Boxer
yeah.
to try to speed things up. They couldn't. I mean, you cannot get the IRS to move faster than they move.
I never would have
guessed. Glacially.
yeah.
And, but it came through in
yeah.
time. And we had a really successful event at the Union. Mm-hmm. And what we did was, Betty Hoover was our events chair.
Mm-hmm.
And what we did was, she did a yeoman's job. I don't know how she did it, but she brought in the jazz clubs. The jazz clubs donated food. And we all slept around and brought the food to the Union, and the jazz clubs just bought into it, and they said, this is a wonderful thing you're doing, and we want to be part of it. So that was
a jazz community coming together. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Huh?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Edith, or Jeffrey, set up this next film having to do with the California Jazz Foundation.
My good friend Richard Clayman, mm-hmm. Who is also a jazz fan, did this film for us at a significant discount.
Mm-hmm.
We had talked about it at our board for a really long time. And
that there was a need
that
to...
That need, mm-hmm. but we couldn't afford it.
Yeah.
And Richard and I belong to an organization, and we were talking one day, and I said, God, I would just love to have you do a film for us, but we can't afford you. And he said, yes, you can.
Mm.
And in fact, he gave us such a good price that that we did. I actually sponsored it, and I was at Joe Rothman's and John McClure's club at the Newport Jazz Festival, Newport Beach Jazz mm-hmm. Festival, the party. And I said to Richard, Richard, if you can do this like this coming weekend, we will have so many musicians here from all over the country.
Okay.
And he did. He said, we'll be there. We'll shoot from 4 to 8. In fact, they shot from 4 to 11.
Mm.
They wouldn't leave. And they brought a makeup person, and they had,
oh, yeah.
It was wonderful. And we had 16 wonderful musicians who we interviewed. They didn't all get on the
final.
Final. Mm-hmm. But it was heartwarming. It was really wonderful.
And this film essentially, in a nutshell, sums up what the foundation's all
exactly.
about and has some spoken commentary about the impact on
exactly.
their specific lives. Let's roll that video now. It's a profile of the California Jazz Foundation. We'll come back with my very special guests, Edith Bronston and Jeffrey Winston.
Them to make the music that moved our feet, that stirred our passions, that warmed our souls.
There were 8 clubs on one side of the street and 8 clubs on the other side, and had the greatest players, Dizzy Gillespie, one, Charlie Parker, another, Oscar Pettiford, one, Coleman Hawkins, Leslie, every club had a, and all the young jazz players were standing in the street.
So by the time you end up at the end of the street, you've jammed at a rock club, a jazz club, a strip joint.
They're cut from a different cloth. They're from an older way of life, an older world, a world that seemed to consist of more respect.
There was a chain of restaurants in Detroit called Checker Barbecue, and they would have after-hour jams.
I go listen to all these great heavyweights, and I learned from Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, and Bud Powell, and whoever played there.
Cat's always at your house playing. We're always rehearsing.
And now, many of them desperately need us.
There was nothing that I thought I couldn't do.
I went from a spoiled, coddled, never had to work wife, corporate wife, to starving jazz musician overnight.
People stopped calling me. You know, people stopped calling me for gigs because they didn't know what they were going to get.
I actually was homeless for a while in Toronto.
I found a building, and I started sleeping in the back of the building, and I did that for about 3 years.
It's not a stable job that has a retirement at the end of it often, and a lot of guys fall through the cracks.
They said they were paying $10 for somebody to come in and clean the restaurant. And I said, well, I'll do it. You know, I was tired of standing in front of McDonald's. I was tired of asking for quarters.
Hank Mobley, one of the saxophone players that played with Miles Davis and the Jazz Messengers in the 50s and 60s, and he died at 56, homeless.
You know, through the drug use and so forth, I had lost all my teeth.
It's a rough business, and it's a rough life, it really is. And anybody can fall on hard times, anybody.
They gave us their art, and now there's a place where you can give back. The nonprofit California Jazz Foundation aids California jazz musicians in crisis by providing access to quality social and economic services for eligible applicants through caring, knowledgeable professionals. Since 2006, we've worked to help these talented artists who have given us so much pleasure over the years, often with so little reward.
These musicians only think about how they're existing when they're working. They don't internalize that maybe someday they won't be able to work.
These are pretty trying times for economically for most artists, you know, especially musicians. And there are quite a few of us who cannot afford health insurance.
I think of the many, many musicians we know that are on their own and don't have family living or living here and are going through bad times.
Most jazz musicians I've met, including myself, never really thought about health care or insurance or any of those things. They're never thinking about music.
It's very, very tough, I think, because it's not the popular music anymore. And it's hard to find clubs. It's just hard to make a living.
A lot of them didn't take good care of themselves, didn't have great resources to, you know, rely on. And I can tell you, and a lot of them had other problems, whether it be substance abuse or mental problems.
I know many guys that have worked really with wonderful musicians and played with the greatest bands and all that stuff, but they didn't get any benefits, or they didn't get, you know, they didn't build up their, or they didn't save their money or whatever.
I know of several musicians who did need help, or people that you thought did have it all put together, and then when they passed away, their spouses didn't have anything. So they didn't really have it together as much as we all thought they did.
I think when we see jazz musicians, we say, these are happy-go-lucky guys, they're doing okay, obviously having a good time and all that sort of thing. But most of them have not prepared for later life.
In under 10 years, the California Jazz Foundation has touched hundreds of jazz musicians, providing rent, mortgage, and utility payments, housing relocation, arranging for medical and dental care, in-home nursing, transportation to physical therapy, discount prescriptions, MRIs, hearing exams, and instrument replacement.
Since being able to access help from the California Jazz Foundation, I've been able to actually visit the dentist and get some much needed dental work done. I've been able to catch up with my landlady, which has really been helpful.
They allowed me to move into a loft downtown in Los Angeles, and I have the front part. I live in the back, and in the front part I have a rehearsal studio.
The California Jazz Foundation was there to help me and my family get through a couple months of where I couldn't work while I was healing from my surgery.
Our economy poses ever-increasing challenges. Many older musicians have no Social Security or insurance. Some see no residuals at all from their important works. As a charitable nonprofit organization, we rely on you. Your membership allows us to continue helping our jazz musicians in time of need.
The California Jazz Foundation has been a godsend for me.
Wow, it's been a lifeline, a godsend. And I'm so grateful for it.
See, I'm getting emotional, but it's been wonderful knowing that there are people out there like Edie and other members of this foundation that are supporting people like myself.
Join us today in helping those artists who have given us so much.
Courage. All right. The California Jazz Foundation, a very, very special organization, I think you'll agree. And I'm joined by two very, very prominent members of that foundation, the president, Miss Edith Bronston, and, or should I say, Ms. Edith Bronston, let's make that very clear. And my buddy from days gone by, we go back to junior high school, believe it or not. How many is about 15 years ago?
Yeah, something like that.
Mr. Jeffrey Winston has joined me once again. It's interesting watching some testimonials during the film where it's clear that this is a very, very important step in their lives. Being helped by this foundation, you could see the emotion. Very special.
And they all want to give back.
Ah.
Every single one of them wants to give back.
Yeah, yeah.
And Keith, oh my God, Keith, anytime we call him, he's there.
Yeah. Extraordinary bass player.
Yes, he is.
Keith was here, right here in Cal State Dominguez Hills, doing a session with Greg Perret, the great guitarist.
Greg is our music director.
Oh, there you go. All right.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
Greg's a busy guy, Mr. Dancing with the Stars himself. All righty. We'll have a few more words to say about this extraordinary foundation, the important work that they continue to do.
You want to give them the website,
yeah,
California Jazz Foundation.
Yeah, they shared it. Yeah, we shared it on several occasions, and we'll show it again. There it is, before your very eyes. There it is on your screen, californiajazzfoundation.org. For those of you who want more information, Edith, go ahead.
We should also stress that everything is confidential. The only time we use the names of people we've helped is when they give us permission to do that. Everything is confidential. Mm-hmm. So, and we have a wonderful social worker who helps to fill out the applications, because it really is daunting. Even though our application is less daunting than most of them, it's still, we're IRS approved, so it's daunting.
Yeah, anytime you're IRS approved, there are hoops you have to jump through, unfortunately. But given the kind of assistance that the foundation provides, you take the time to fill in the blanks and fill them in correctly. Yeah, absolutely. We're going to switch reels briefly. Not briefly, we're going to switch reels. And we opened up this evening's
Affair, our very last broadcast of the fall semester 2013, with the spotlight on a gentleman who hails from Los Angeles, who just recently left us. I think it's been a little better than a week that we lost the great Chico Hamilton, one of the great drummers. And I want to go back in time to the mid-1970s and feature Chico Hamilton with yet another quintet, arguably his most famous quintet. What it is, essentially, is a reunion of his quintet from the mid-50s. They came back together in the mid-1970s to make some music and celebrate their coming together. The Chico Hamilton Quintet, which in the mid-70s, actually in the mid-50s, and then at the reunion in the mid-70s, included the likes of one of the great reed men of our time and personalities, the great Buddy Collette, one of the few jazz cellists, and arguably the best in the business, Mr. Fred Katz, and a few other surprises that I think you'll enjoy. This is the Chico Hamilton Band from 1975 in concert. Going to play a Buddy Collette line entitled Buddy Boo. We'll come back. Thank you.
For your listening pleasure and viewing pleasure as well, the Chico Hamilton Quintet. This is a reunion of sorts back in the 1950s. Chico brought together Buddy Collette, who you saw on tenor saxophone in this case, as well as cellist Fred Katz, and they made some very, very unique musical happenings back in the mid-50s. They were reunited in the mid-70s, they did a tour. And in this case, Fred Katz again on cello, Buddy Collette playing with the band. Of course, Buddy, master woodwind artist, flute, alto, tenor, you name it, Buddy played it. And just a spirit, unlike many. He was a special cat. The other gentleman in the band, Barry Finnerty on bass. I'm sorry, on guitar. And the bassist. When I first saw this video, I said, he looks familiar, but I just can't make the connection. That bassist just happens to be Steve Turay. Yes, the same Steve Turay, noted trombonist, conch shell player, one of the great trombone artists of our time. Well, when he was a kid, he played a little bass as well. In this case, electric bass. Just a multi-talented cat, Steve Turay on bass. The Chico Hamilton Quintet from 1975. My guests in here in this little room of ours out at Cal State Dominguez Hills, Edie Bronston and Jeffrey Winston have joined me this evening, and we are talking about several subjects, among them the California Jazz Foundation, almost said society, the California Jazz Foundation, and they are very, very important members of that foundation. And we're talking about some people who left us, including the gentleman we just spotlighted, the great Chico Hamilton. Jeffrey, Chico Hamilton, Jefferson High School alumnus, LA native. Talk about Chico, man.
All of that and more, Chet. Chico came out of the Sam Brown tutelage, like so many others.
Yep.
Ernie Andrews, the list just goes on. And Chico came out of that tradition. Of course, Jefferson High School, geographically, is just a couple of blocks from Central Avenue. So it's right there running parallel with the boulevard.
Right.
And that was a mainstay, as you know,
yeah.
30s, 40s, and 50s. Forrest Thornton Hamilton was born in Los Angeles on September 20th in 1921. When asked how he got the name Chico, he simply said, "I was a small dude."
Okay.
Very makes simple sense. Answer.
Makes sense.
His mother, Pearl, was a school dietitian, and his father worked at the University Club of Southern California. And like Dexter Gordon and Ernie Andrews, as I said, and along with scores of others, they were all under the wings of Sam.
The great Samuel
That's
Brown.
That's right.
Yep.
I was at a ceremony a few years ago where they were dedicating the auditorium at Jefferson High in his honor, mm-hmm. renaming it,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of luminaries came out for that ceremony. While still a student at Jefferson, Chico immersed himself immediately in the local jazz scene, particularly in Central Avenue. He was touring with Lionel Hampton by 1940.
All right.
So his career took off,
huh?
Yeah, very early.
Wow.
And then after a brief stint in the military, during World War II, he had brief stints with Jimmy Mundy, Count Basie, Charlie Burnett. And in 1946, Hamilton was the house drummer at Billy Berg's. So that was right around the time when a huge meteorite landed in Hollywood, and that was Bebop, Bird and Dizzy,
yes.
electrifying the West Coast with a whole new genre.
Boy, we could probably do an entire session, Jeffrey, on Billy Bird's.
Sure.
And all that went on in the
1940s. That's right. That's
oh,
right.
And you should.
Something for the future.
And during that time, he also moonlighted as a member of Jerry Mulligan's quartet.
Right.
This was really the birth of cool jazz. West Coast, he put it on the map,
yeah.
kind of the other side of the dichotomy from bebop, the understated, the subtle nuances.
Mm-hmm.
Chet Baker, of course, was involved in that group as
and
well.
Some real, real interesting harmonies
yeah.
that those bands put together.
That's right.
Because so often they were pianoless, which mm-hmm. required a different harmonic conception.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Good stuff. Yeah.
So Chico recorded his first album with bassist George DeVivier and Howard Roberts on guitar. He formed a quintet with unusual instrumentation. And
right.
you've alluded to that
right.
a little earlier. We're talking cello and guitar mm-hmm. and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
People like, as you said, Buddy Collette, Fred Katz, John Pisano joined the group. And they appeared in a film called
Another
The Sweet
Special
Smell
cat, John
of Success.
Pisano. Oh, man. Guitar
yeah.
supreme. Yes.
That's right. They all appeared in a film called The Sweet Smell of Success,
mm.
starring Tony Curtis and Burt Lancaster.
Mm-hmm.
Three years later...
Wait, who are they?
I'm
really familiar with them. The musicians, yes, but Lancaster and Curtis.
And then 3 years later, Eric Dolphy came along. I know you know that guy. He joined the group, and Eric had a cameo appearance in a film called Jazz on a Summer's Day,
right.
which was Bert Stern's highly acclaimed documentary about the Newport Jazz Festival.
Mm. That's a classic.
1958, yes. Yeah. So Chico's trailblazing ensembles included later George Bohannon, Gabor Szabo, as you mentioned, Albert Stinson, the late great bassist,
mm-hmm.
Charles Lloyd. These were risk takers and avant-garde at his best. Everyone remembers Passing Through and The Man from Two Worlds, two prolific dates on Impulse.
Mm.
The thing about Chico is that he always was able to reinvent himself. So just when the cool jazz kind of subsided, he was going on to something else.
Yeah.
Always looking for a new sound and just always on the cutting edge. Defying all categories, no classifications, no genres with names. He did it all.
Chico was a special man,
mm-hmm.
special man. And again, we can connect in as much as our fathers went to Jeff.
Mm-hmm.
Small world, huh?
There's another connection. You and I went to Dorsey with Chico's daughter, Denise Hamilton.
Denise Hamilton.
Yeah, she was there too.
Small world.
Yeah.
Can I tell you?
And one day my dad, I was about 15, 16, he said, let's go around the corner for a ride. And I had no idea what he was talking about. So we went over to 6th Avenue, right near 39th Street.
Yeah.
And it was, we were going over to Chico's house. So he took me over there, introduced me to Chico, and Chico had a little studio in the back, in the back house, and he had all the toys there. So that was a special day.
Oh, I can imagine.
Yeah.
Chico Hamilton, a very special cat. We will miss him, but thank goodness for recorded music. Right.
And he certainly had longevity at 92. He did a lot of jingles, commercials, movie scoring, television shows.
Very versatile cat.
Yeah, very versatile. One thing you may want to notice, too, I want to point out in those videos, he had his cymbals very low. Every drummer has a different pod or different setup. He had he carried his cymbals low. One cymbal was at knee level. And so, you know, people have different reasons. Some drummers don't like to reach high when they ride. Some like to see the audience, make contact. Others, it's very important when you're on the bandstand to have visual cues with the other artists. So for a number of reasons, he liked a clear field of vision.
That's Chico.
And he loved the mallets and the brushes. You know, have many tools in your toolbox.
Well, different nuances that he could get with
exactly.
mallets.
Yeah,
great stuff. Edith Bronston, I'm going to mention one name, and I just want you to, whatever comes to mind. Charlie Parker.
My hero.
You and practically every other jazzer out there, huh?
Yeah, I'm a Bird girl.
All right.
Every time I get a new cell phone, I download another Charlie Parker for my ringtone.
All right. Speaking of Bird, we're going to feature one of the giants, one of the innovators. As Jeff and I are always commenting on, you have musicians, as we speak, who are still chasing Bird. And they're falling, a lot of them are falling further and further behind because he was a very, very special musician who arguably, when you consider, and this is really an artificial designation, but if you considered the four most important jazz people in the history of this music, you could maybe begin with Louis Armstrong. You have to include Ellington, right? And you have to include Bird.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah, it's as simple as that. We're going to
maybe
feature.
Dizzy.
Yeah, I'm going to throw Dizzy in there. Yeah. And later period people say, well, you have to include Coltrane and Miles, but that's for another discussion. you got to begin with Pops, Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, and Charlie Parker. We're going to feature the great Bird doing his interpretation of All of Me. We'll come back.
Thank you.
That's bebop at its best, ladies and gentlemen. The great Charlie Parker on alto saxophone interpreting All of Me. And full disclosure, what you just heard is the magic of technology. That was Bird wailing on alto saxophone. But the cats playing with him weren't playing with him when he made that recording. This is taken from the original soundtrack from the motion picture Bird, starring Forest Whitaker, that came out, I believe, in 1988, 89, somewhere in that neighborhood. And the cats working with Bird, again, electronically, if you will, Barry Harris, the piano, Ray Brown on bass, John Guerin on drums. They were able to lift Charlie Parker's track and technically splice it, if you will, to modern cats, again, the Barry Harris's, the Ray Browns of the world, to essentially boost the rhythm section that you heard. But that was Bird on alto, wailing like very few people, if for that matter, no one could play like Bird, and no one can play like Bird. Charlie Parker, a true immortal. And Ida, I have to agree with you. Bird's the man. Bird's the word, huh?
Bird's the word.
My guests, Jeffrey Winston and Edie Bronston, both very, very important people involved in a very, very important organization, the California Jazz Foundation. Upcoming events.
We are honoring Ruth Price, the founder and the guiding light and driving force behind the Jazz Bakery.
Yes.
We will be honoring her at our gala on April the 6th, which is a Sunday. It'll be at the Downtown Hotel that used to be the Hyatt and is in the process of being renamed from the LA Downtown Hotel. We don't know what it's going to be called yet. But it's going to be wonderful. It's going to be a warm and wonderful evening with lots of people playing and lots of people telling their Ruth Price stories.
Is this a part of your annual or semi-annual
coming together? Yes, it's our
annual
fundraiser.
There you go.
Last year we honored Catalina at Catalina's, mm-hmm. and we and Arturo Sandoval played, mm-hmm. and it was a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful event.
That's
great. So we're looking forward to match it. Ruth has never been honored. Can you believe that?
No.
I know.
Can't.
It's hard to imagine.
And needless to say, Edith, I think all of us are looking forward to the grand reopening and new location for the bakery.
Yes, we are.
Yeah.
Yes, we are.
That's going to be something special. What have you heard? Nothing confirmed, but I'm sure at this point, but have you heard in terms of the bakery rising from the ashes, if you will? Have you heard anything?
I have seen a rendering. They've got all their permits, I understand.
Okay.
They've got all the Frank Gehry sketches. Everything is done. They've got a model that nobody's allowed to see except the people who are on the committee.
Yeah.
I don't know when it's going to be unveiled. When it is unveiled, it'll be part of our whole big publicity splash. But right now, it's not. They need money, like we all do.
Yeah.
It's tough. It's very tough getting funding for musicians and for music. It's mm-hmm. and the arts. It's mm-hmm. just
well, you know, Jeff
terrible.
And I. Jeff and I have talked about this on any number of occasions. Unfortunately, and this has been the case since the 40s, jazz is not America's popular music. And, you know, when you consider record sales, and that's a whole other issue,
because
that whole paradigm has shifted. Jazz is in the bottom 5% of sales, if you will. But one thing is certain. Jazz people, jazz aficionados are the most loyal music fans, I think, in the world.
Yeah.
And they will follow this music wherever it
But we are getting older.
Yeah, that's why it's really so critical that we involve a younger listening audience.
Yeah.
It's a two-pronged approach, not just developing talent mm-hmm. musicians, and of course they're coming out of the colleges,
yes.
but also young, trained ears who can appreciate this music. Plant the seed early.
Bingo.
And with Ruth, there's a lot of anticipation about this reopening.
Yes.
Because she's been kind of almost a gypsy woman, if you will.
Yeah.
Kind of a venue on wheels, yeah. Presenting different performers, yeah. At various venues. Now she'll have a home again. And as I make my rounds, people are always saying, when is the jazz?
When's the bakery going to reopen?
Right.
Yes.
Right.
I get that all the time.
Yeah.
And that's it. I wish I knew.
She loses money on every one of those venues. You know, she's charged a lot of money.
Yeah. Wow.
It's very sad. Mm.
We're in a bebop mode here. We just featured the great Charlie Parker. We're going to continue in a similar vein. We're going to slow the tempo down, however, and feature one of Bird's disciples. And he and his band are going to interpret My Old Flame. This is the Phil Woods Quartet. Uh-oh.
Thank you.
Phil Woods on alto saxophone, interpreting My Old Flame, another favorite that Charlie Parker used to play. Inevitably, during his sets, Bird would play All of Me, he'd play My Old Flame, and Embraceable You, among many other tunes that were in Bird's book back in the day. But in this case, this is one of Bird's disciples, one of many, the great Phil Woods, working with Hal Galper at the piano, Bill Goodwin on drums, Steve Gilmore on bass. Great, great stuff, the great Phil Woods. This was recorded, by the way, at Cannes, at one of their festivals in France in 1990. It was a tribute to Charlie Parker. And what I want to do next is, after I reintroduce my very special guests, is share another video clip of another band at that very same festival honoring and paying tribute to the great Charlie Parker, doing another tune closely associated with Bird. But before we do that, let me reintroduce my very special guests. To my immediate right, Miss Edith Bronston, attorney at law, president of the California Jazz Foundation. And it's so great that you could come. Listen, it's almost become a cliche when I introduce a guest and I say thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. Well, sometimes it's not as busy as it may sound, but I know with you, Edie, you have a very, very busy schedule.
I do.
A million thank yous for spending some time with us.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you. And to Edie's right is, again, longtime colleague, friend, classmate, you name it, Mr. Jeffrey Winston, historian, officer in the California Jazz Foundation, aficionado, and he's done it all with regard to this music. And please stay tuned because we have another 90 minutes, and there's a lot more I want to share with you. Come on, let's say it together. So much music, so little time. But we're going to try to cover as much as we can in our remaining 90 minutes, given the fact that this is our final broadcast of the fall semester. We just heard Phil Woods. We're going to listen to another band that happened to be at the same Tribute to Bird Festival at Cannes in France. This is the Red Rodney Frank Morgan Quartet. And needless to say, Red Rodney spent a considerable period, period of time with Bird, but definitely he made his mark playing in Bird's band. Before we do that, let's take our first call of the evening because we are interactive and I invite your calls. Mike from Sherman Oaks. Mike, welcome.
Hi,
again, my friend.
Congratulations on your guests are great.
Oh, well, hey, I'm honored to have them in here with me, Mike.
Oh, yeah.
They bring so much to the table. And
they're doing so much to the table, or our music, you know.
That's right.
That's wonderful to hear and see.
Thank you, Mike. What's happening, Mike? Tell me something good.
I'm a little delay here. I was going to call you, in fact, about Chico, but you got ahead of me on that.
Was there something specific that we could share that wasn't shared about Chico?
Well,
Hamilton?
There was something, no, not really. That was pretty much it, dates, you know, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, Mike, just keep watching. I don't have to tell you to keep watching because you've been watching this program since we've been on the air. So
there was an article on Monk. There was an article on Monk the previous week, I believe, which was also very positive. Of course, we're not dealing with Leonard Feather here, but it was great.
Well, Mike, let me just make this comment, if I may. You're bringing up, you're having me recollect things that suddenly I don't recollect like I used to.
So, neither do I, baby.
I appreciate that. But, Mike, longtime viewer and listener, thank you so much for being there and enjoying this music. All right, that's Mike from Sherman Oaks, regular viewer. It's always good to know that he's out there enjoying this music. Red Rodney, Frank Morgan, the band, among them Roy Haynes, Rufus Reed, Monty Alexander. One of Bird's favorites, Blues for Alice. We'll come back. Thank you.
The Red Rodney, Frank Morgan Quintet. Red Rodney, of course, one of my very special guests, Jeffrey Winston, reminded me of a period when Red Rodney toured with Charlie Parker. And for reasons that I won't get into at any length, he was billed as Albino Red. And that's a story that we will get into maybe next semester. Anyway, Red Rodney on trumpet, Frank Morgan on alto saxophone, Monty Alexander on piano, Rufus Reed on bass, and the immortal Roy Haynes on drums. And you talk about a musician who has played with everybody in the business, including Louis Armstrong, among many, many others.
It's hard to believe.
Yeah, and is still playing. It's amazing. And he's in his mid to late 80s. And
Pops to Pat Metheny and beyond.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All those years with Sassy.
Extraordinary. Yeah. Extraordinary. Just amazing. Again, I'm visited and joined by Jeffrey Winston and Edie Bronston. And it's just such a delight for me to have both of you come out and join me. We lost Chico Hamilton about a week ago, a little better than a week ago. And in that same time frame, we lost another young man, I can say it with confidence, who one of the most unsung or undersung pianists out there. And Jeffrey and I were lamenting earlier in the evening that 2013 has been a rough year for pianists. We've lost any number of great pianists this year, and you look up and we lost another one in Nate Morgan. Nate Morgan, some of you may not be familiar with that name, but Nate, one of the best, and you're going to find out why we consider Nate Morgan one of the best. Jeff, talk about Nate a little bit, and we'll come back. I want to share some of his artistry, and then we'll follow up with a little more information on the great Nate Morgan.
Nate was just so incredible. As you said, unsung, unheralded. Really, when you think about his mentor, you can see where he came from, that mentor being Horace Tapscott and the ARC, Pan-African People's Orchestra. And it's really an extended family. Poets, sculptors, artists, and not just performing artists, but visual artists.
Yes, yes.
You know, people like Dwight Tribble and Kamau Daoud, Jesse Sharps, James Smith, Azar, Fawasi.
Yeah, all the local cats. Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
And it was an organic, evolving kind of ensemble. They played at prisons, parks, churches, storefronts, you name it. Mm-hmm. And
frankly, for next to nothing.
Right.
Yes.
Exactly.
They played because they loved the music.
And the whole philosophy was, it's not competitive, as Horace Tapscott would say, it's participatory.
Yes.
And he really didn't care what level you were on. He wanted to make it all-inclusive for so many.
That's special.
Right.
Yeah.
Also, we can mention our good friend that you had a connection with, Adele Sebastian.
Adele Sebastian.
Yeah.
Oh.
That's a name that goes back.
Oh, yeah. Again, that's fodder for another program we could do.
But Nate was principally influenced by Stanley Cowell and McCoy Tyner.
McCoy Tyner, right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Heavy left hand. Mm-hmm. The notes just were cascading, you know, just intricate tapestries of sound.
And you and I had the singular opportunity to interview Nate as part of our World Stage Stories series.
That's right.
Again, for those of you who may not be familiar with that series that we did a few years ago, we had the singular opportunity to interview about 70-plus musicians or people connected with this music over a period of about
5 years.
5 years, mm-hmm. Okay. And Nate was one of those special people. And Jeffrey, share with the audience our format, how we would go about conducting that session called
basically
World
would
Stage
have
Stories.
About an hour's interview, mm-hmm. and we'd follow up with about 10 minutes of Q&A. And then we'd take a brief break and come back with about a 20-minute mini clinic. The artist would play two or three tunes of their choice or demonstrate a certain technique. So the whole component was about 90 minutes in length.
Yeah.
And it was very interactive. People in the audience were invited to ask questions and to make comments.
Mm-hmm. All taking place where?
At the World Stage.
World Stage.
The home of the human metronome, Billy Higgins. Opened in 1989.
89, mm-hmm. Yeah. We're going to get more into that in just a moment. But
let us share now some of the artistry of the late Nate Morgan. And this is that portion of the interview where the artist actually demonstrates his or her talents. And with Nate, it's extraordinary talent. And you'll hear, for those of you that are familiar with the likes of Stanley Cowell and in particular McCoy Tyner, you'll hear that distilled by the one, the only, Mr. Nate Morgan. Check this out.
Thank you.
good stuff. Good stuff. All done at the World Stage in the heart of the Mert Park back in 2006 when we had the rare opportunity to interview a giant who just left us in the last few days, Mr. Nate Morgan. Of course, the tune, You Don't Know What Love Is Until You Know the Meaning of the Blues, as interpreted by a giant, Mr. Nate Morgan. You probably caught a glimpse of a gentleman who visited me about 2 or 3 weeks ago, Mr. Clint Rosemond. World Stage Stories was his brainchild, and Jeffrey is the man who did most of the work, if not all of it, most of the time. I just happened to tag along and be have an opportunity to be involved in the interview process, but it was invaluable in as much as we counted roughly about 70 plus interviews, and about 20 of those individuals have gone on to play in the big bandstand in the sky. So we feel fortunate that we had the opportunity to spotlight these great, great talents and then have them demonstrate some of those talents.
Absolutely.
Good stuff.
We want to also make mention of the Nimbus label because Nate did record for them one particular release called Retribution Reparation. And Nate was on piano, Danny Cortez trumpet, Jesse Sharps reeds, Joey Ector on bass, and Fritz Wise.
Fritz.
On drums. Mm-hmm. Another one, there was Sharps and Flats with Jesse Sharps. Yeah. He was the leader out front.
Right.
Steve Smith on trumpet, the usual suspects, Joey Ector, and our good friend Carl Burnett on drums.
Carl joined me about a month and a half ago. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of fun. Yeah, it's great stuff.
Nate was also heard on a Renaissance with Phil Ranlin and the Tribe, with about 20 artists.
And if you stay tuned, you just might get a glimpse of Nate in concert, but I don't want to give anything away. Again, that was filmed at the World Stage, and a huge thank you to Brother Hikima, who did so instrumental in documenting those great, great concerts.
Nate suffered a long time.
Yeah.
There was the stroke, the diabetes, the hypertension, paralysis on his left side, and musicians would go frequently to his home and play for him and have an ongoing vigil. And so, you know, bringing him inspiration and strength.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And his service will be this coming Saturday.
This coming Saturday.
Oh.
Yes, it's coming up 1/13/33 Atlantic in Linwood.
Linwood.
Right. Okay. 10 a.m. this Saturday, December 7th, at the New Christian Unity Center.
Right. Right.
And so it's going to be a marathon. Repass will be in the same location. Mm-hmm. Everyone will be there from the community. It's an outpouring of love and respect for one of our ancestors now.
One of our ancestors, the great Nate Morgan. Again, that was filmed at the World Stage. Talk about the World Stage, if you would, Jeff. What's happening down there in Leimert Park?
Well, it's evolved. It's certainly been, those walls are sacred, hollow ground. A lot of people have walked through those doors.
Ooh, indeed.
Joe Henderson, Barry Harris, Charles Lloyd, Max Roach, the list goes on and on. Mm-hmm. Opened in 1989, co-founded by the poet Kamau Daoud and the great drummer Billy Higgins.
Right.
And a lot of people don't realize it, but I mentioned that name again. Carl Burnett was instrumental too in its opening. The very chairs and the stage that were at his venue, Artworks 4, were transported over to the World Stage.
Right.
So he was right there at the forefront as well.
Yeah, Artworks 4 was around the corner.
Exactly.
From the stage.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
So the stage has really been a lot of things to a lot of people. There are workshops every night, there's children's lessons on the weekends, spoken word on Wednesday nights. Howlett Smith comes in on Tuesday with a vocal class. Cornell Fowler gives his drum lessons to toddlers.
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah, that's great.
And
you haven't lived, and I can speak from experience. You haven't lived until you walked into the World Stage and focused on these little bitty kids on these little bitty kits.
Right.
Just playing up a storm. It's something to see.
Pat Cornell said he's going to make me continue to play on a baby kit until I learn my rudiments.
Oh, Cornell's rough. Cornell is rough. Yikes.
But it's a very modest venue, just a storefront. Mm-hmm. Karan, who was a major protege of Billy, grew up there, sitting in Billy's lap when he was two or three.
Caron Harrison.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. And he's gone on to greater things.
Yes.
But the stage has always been a grassroots kind of operation, mm-hmm. all volunteer, nobody's getting paid. And so it's kind of fallen on hard times. And for the last several months, we've been in a real crisis mode, scuffling just to pay the rent, which is about $1,400 a month.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of gentrification that's occurring, not just in Leimert Park, but all across the country. You see brownstones in Philly and Boston and DC, New York, being transformed, and people are being priced out. And the same thing is happening here. Developers, it's all about the money, you know, it's all about profit.
That's right.
And so the arts.
Money talks.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
The arts always take a back seat.
Yes.
So we are looking for benefactors, and not just deep pockets, but just everyday people who can come to our aid. And the ideal situation is to own. We want to get out of this rent mode where we're at the mercy of the landlord. We don't even have a lease. It's just a month-to-month rental agreement. Mm. The landlords have been operating in a shroud of secrecy, using the management company kind of as a buffer. So we want to come to the table with them, see what their plans are. But obviously the plan is for gentrification, because you've got the corridor coming in, the Crenshaw Line, the Metro.
Light rail. Yeah,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
3 to 4 years down the pike.
Right.
And that's going to be a huge factor in this game.
Mm, indeed.
So we haven't had the response that we would like from some of our elected officials, but we have had some assistance from Herb Wesson's office. We want to continue that dialogue. We want to get Leimert Park deemed a historical monument, that whole area.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a lot of film, there's a lot of photos and images that have documented the era, and we're trying to archive that. Yeah. But in terms of the stage, they've had some strategic planning meetings recently. They want to formalize their plan in terms of short-term, mid-range, and long-range. Yeah. The immediate plan is to raise $25,000 to be able to pay our rent without this crisis mode for the next few months. And then beyond that, we really want to identify and explore some options to buy. Even if it's not there, people are connected spiritually to the venue. We understand that, a lot of sentimental value. But also, when the church moves, the congregation goes with
That's
it.
That's right.
So there are other options that we want to explore too.
What's that website for the World Stage?
TheWorldStage.org.
TheWorldStage.org. Make a mental note, folks, or write it down. Don't make mental notes. Pull out that computer in your pocket. Plug it in, theworldstage.org. Let's take a call. You're on with Edith, Jeffrey, and me. Natalie from L.A. Natalie, welcome again, my dear. Go ahead.
Thank you, my precious one.
Hi, Natalie.
I'm fine.
Go ahead, Natalie, please.
Okay. I'm not going to look at the TV, and I've turned off the sound. I see Jeffrey, and I remember all those years he was on the set when we were doing the benefits for those musicians that left us. Always a face in the crowd and always there.
That's right.
And thank you, Jeffrey.
You're
and
welcome.
Edie, I met quite some time ago, but I know she was there too. But, you know, they're fighting for the same thing that I always scream so loud about. Why do musicians have to beg for the little bit that we give them? They're the background of our lives. Their music, we hear it 24/7,
mm-hmm.
and for them to have to do the things that they do and live the way they live, it's almost insulting to me. And so you're asking for $25,000. It seems like such a small amount, and all they are doing is asking to survive, to bring this music, jazz, I say bebop, to a couple of generations who are letting it just go awry. So I want to thank you, Jeffrey. Thank you so much.
You're
and you too, Edie. And of course, Chet, I never say goodbye because I'll be looking at the next set. I just want to remind us that we had quite a few benefits for those musicians that so deserved it. So they just deserved it. And
no
we
question.
Should have been there.
You've been in the trenches a long time now, Natalie.
That's right.
Our hats are off to you as well.
Indeed.
Okay.
Natalie, always a pleasure, lady.
It's my pleasure.
Oh,
thank you all.
And Natalie, let me give you and the other viewers a bit of good news.
Okay.
Guess who returns in the spring? Yours truly.
We'll be back in the spring, fortunately, with another 14 or 15 sessions of Jazz in the Modern Era. Our first date is Tuesday, January 21st. And I think we'll hit it 9, Natalie.
Okay, you just made my year.
Thank you, lady.
What a gift.
So great to hear from you, Natalie. Thanks so much.
The best to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Natalie. All right, great call. You talk about an aficionado. Oh, man, that Natalie is...
And speaking of the world stage, yes. Rose Gales has been the virtual backbone of the jam session scene in Los Angeles for the better part of 40 years, whether it's at the stage or at her home. She recently had a medical setback, but she's fine. She was in the hospital for about a week. Yeah. She convalesced at home for about 2 weeks, and then this past Sunday she returned. Mm. Feisty as ever.
That's
so
Rose.
We're glad to have Rose back.
And we had the opportunity to interview as part of World Stage Stories, and that was quite a session. Jeffrey mentioned that one of the founders of the World Stage, the drummer extraordinaire, Mr. Billy Higgins. We're going to feature Higgins working with a quartet of renowned. I'm going to go back to Sweet Basil back in 1990 and enjoy this quartet. Playing a tune entitled Art Song. The band, Art Farmer on flugelhorn, Cedar Walton at the piano, Ron Carter on bass, and our man Higgins on drums. Enjoy this. Thank you. Farmer on flugelhorn, Cedar Walton, who we lost this year, on piano, Ron Carter on bass, and Billy Higgins, the immortal Billy Higgins, on drums. Recorded at Sweet Basil's in New York City, when Sweet Basil's was still going strong, 1990 to be exact. My guests, Edith Bronston, Jeffrey Winston, they were good enough to join me this evening, and it's a pleasure for me to have them come out and share this music with me and with you as well. Let's take a quick call and we'll continue with the music. You're on with Clint Rosemond himself. Clint, go ahead, please.
Hey, Chet.
Yes.
Edie and Jeff.
Hey, Clint.
Hey, Clint.
All right, good to see all of you. Lots going on there. Edie's work is outstanding, and everybody listening should make a contribution to the California Jazz Foundation. They do great work, and it's kind of one of a kind. It's exceptional effort, and you're to be lauded for it. But most of all, anybody who is also listening, make a holiday gift to California Jazz Foundation, whatever you can. They'll appreciate it. Secondly, you play a lot of Charlie Parker. And there's a great book out on Charlie Parker by Stanley Crouch.
Stanley
if you're a Charlie Parker fan or just a jazz fan, you should really read it. It's very well written, very informative. You get to see a whole different perspective of Bird. He was a spoiled brat, basically. but he learned how to play the horn very well.
That's right.
And to Nate. Nate was a real virtuoso. Didn't know what he was playing until the last, 30 seconds of the tune. But it was really interesting to hear him play that again on tape because he made a few mistakes. And that's the great part about this music, is that you've got to be willing to take those chances so that, you do every now and then hit the wrong note. And that's the thrilling part about the music. It's exciting because it takes a daring personality to play it. There are a lot of people who play music, but it's not exciting because it's predictable. And the way Nate played, the music was not predictable.
That's right.
So may his soul rest in peace, and we'll pay tribute to him this Sunday. A couple of other things. Art Farmer, Frank Morgan, also both Jeffersonians.
Exactly.
They were under the tutelage of Sam Brown as well. And finally, about the world stage and its problem, I was at Minton's Playhouse, the Cecil Hotel, 118th and St. Nicholas, about a month ago when I went back to visit my family and discovered that Bertha was playing in the band up there, Bertha, my sister. And I went up there, and Ralph Parsons, the CEO of American Express, now runs that operation. And you want to talk about gentrification in Harlem? The price was $125 per person, price fixed menu. After the community spoke to Mr. Parsons, he said, okay, well, they dropped the price to $95.
Oh,
no bargain.
It's a $50 minimum. Woo. $50 minimum, okay? So, now that's real gentrification.
That's really sad.
Okay, so this stuff that's going on at World Stage, trying to pay $1,400 a month, it's really, I know it's a struggle. I ran the World Stage for 15 years.
That's right.
I paid the rent for this, so I know what that's about. But it's really just about paying the rent. And so pay the rent, find a way to make the money, or buy a building. Somebody else has already bought that building, and they have their own plans. But the World Stage, as we used to say, it's not a place, it's a spirit. And as you said, the church, the congregation goes with the church. So That's enough for tonight. You guys carry on. Take care.
Thank you, Clint.
Thank you.
As always, man, it's always great to have you. Join me again this semester, and obviously, the man knows of what he speaks.
Oh, yeah.
One thing I didn't mention is, in fact, when he was here, I don't think I mentioned the fact that Clint was the executive director of the World Stage for, as he mentioned, 15 years. So he knows what he's talking about. Jeffrey.
And as of September 1st, Dwight Tribble has assumed that role.
Mm-hmm.
So he's at the helm right now. Another person we want to mention, a longtime treasurer, the late Jay Rich. Jammin' Jay Rich was very committed. He was a businessman because in addition to being an air personality, for so many years, he was the sales manager at KBCA and at KJLH.
Right.
He sold accounts. He understood the business.
Indeed. Absolutely.
Trevor Ware was the former board president.
Stay tuned on Trevor.
Yep.
I mentioned earlier on that Billy Higgins, co-founder of the World Stage back in the late 80s, the other co-founder, Kamau Daoud, noted poet. Let's hear from Kamau. I think this is a perfect opportunity to share the title track from his date entitled, what else? Leimert Park. This is Kamau Daoud.
My heart is a djembe drum, played upon by the dark hands of a Fifth Street cappuccino. My invisible turban is an angelic saxophone solo. The sidewalk is hardened mud cloth, massaging the soles of my feet. I do West African dance steps, reflecting the sun off my Stacy Adams shoes. I stand on the OG corner and tell old school stories with a bebop tongue to the hip-hop future. I see new rainbows in their eyes as we stand in puddles of melted chains. Visit the black sensei with a grumpy voice wrapped in juju and warrior spirits guarding a room full of stereotypes and ancestral stories. A Moor in a pork pie hat stands with a video camera in front of a stained glass musician. I low-ride on a zebra in front of Congo Square. We clothe ourselves in sun in Africa by the yard. Hand-woven the fabric of our life we sculpture. You see, there are trees in Leimert Park under which old men do divination with the bones of dominoes. Degnan, a river, a new Nile on whose banks young poets sharpen their hearts on the polyrhythms of Billy Higgins' smile. On the world stage where Tab Scott's fingers massage your collective memory. At the crossroads, a vision is shaped by a woman who labored as a maid and gave her wages to her village. Here where children play double dutch with dreadlock ropes and believers wash the streets with Quranic tears under a kente sky. Vomit up your television set. Take a deep breath and exhale your fear. Scrub the tombstones of those who die young until they become mirrors in which to see yourself. Take long stares at your hand until true love returns to your touch. Then touch. Stand right in a garment of light. I want to pour poems into the open arms of your drums. I want to get in between your piano keys and unleash the healing secrets. I want to stuff your dreams with a bed of cleansing herbs. I want to wipe the bull's eyes off the backs of your children in Leimert Park.
Co-founder of the World Stage back in the late 80s, Kamau Daoud, the date entitled Leimert Park, and that's the title track. And the spoken word, obviously, provided by Kamau. Some of the gentlemen on this particular date included Horace Tapscott, who you heard Jeffrey talk about earlier. Nate Morgan is also playing piano on some of the tracks. The drummer, Billy Higgins. Bassist, Dr. Art Davis. Roberto Miranda is playing bass. A lot of local great musicians on this particular date, entitled again, Lamert Park by Kamau Daoud. It goes back to 1997. This is Jazz the Modern Era as we are rapidly approaching the 10 o'clock hour when we have to leave the air, unfortunately, and it's been a joy for me to have some special people join me again, Edith Bronston and Jeffrey Winston. We've been talking about Lamert Park, and Jeffrey mentioned the ARC, the Pan-African People's Orchestra. Back in 2006, the ARC, how many pieces? Maybe 18 pieces strong. They did a concert at a lady's home. And you talk about another special person who we lost recently, Miss Mimi Melnick. Mimi's Salon was quite the place to be to hear some of the great cutting-edge music of our time. And the Pan-African People's Orchestra did a concert there back in 2006. And I want to feature this band of renown, all these great local cats coming together to interpret a Charles Mingus tune that I think will get your blood boiling a little bit. So we're going to go back. 2006, they're going to play Moanin', the Charles Mingus classic. This is the Pan-African People's Orchestra.
Thank you.
Pan-African People's Orchestra in performance at Mimi's Salon back in 2006. Those of you who get out on a fairly regular basis to see some of the local talent probably recognize a few faces in that particular band. Headed up by Michael Session, who also played alto saxophone, just some of the cats in the band. The drummer, that's Michael Session's son, Michaela.
My mic fell off.
I'm talking to no one. One moment, please. All right, take two. That band, the Pan-African People's Orchestra, thank you, Jeffrey, for calling it to my attention. That band, headed up by Michael Session on alto saxophone, the Pan-African People's Orchestra, recorded at Mimi's Salon back in 2006. And it included the likes of, again, Michael Session on alto saxophone, that little guy on drums. He was 11 years old at the time. That's Michael Session's son, Michaela. He has since gone on to graduate from that new arts high school in downtown LA on 4th and Grand and is now at Cal Arts. So good things happen to young people when they get in this music. That was Rimber James on trombone. The saxophone section included Amos DeLone on baritone taking the lead on Charles Mingus's Monin. Azar Lawrence is in the saxophone section. Charles Chandler, Tracy Caldwell, the young lady on the far right in the picture. Steve Smith on trumpet, Fundi Lagone on French horn, and Nate Morgan. We've talked about Nate this evening. Nate was on piano, not featured on this particular tune, but he was definitely part of that band. Trevor Ware and Nick Rosen, the bass players. Just an outstanding group of musicians coming together at the house of a very, very special lady who we lost. Was it this year?
Yeah.
We lost Mimi Melnick this year.
Wasn't it this year?
Yeah. Was it this year or late last year?
No, this year.
This year, yeah. Quickly, thoughts about Mimi and all that she contributed to this music. And I know it's tough to do in just a few moments, but your recollections, your fondest recollections of Mimi.
Me?
Yeah, either of you.
Mimi was amazing. She was very low-key. She was very unassuming, and she had the most avant-garde people in her living room regularly.
That's right.
It was quite remarkable, and she did it with no fuss, no muss. Mm-hmm. She was quite a gal.
That was her niche, was the artists that normally don't get booked in clubs because they're risk takers.
Yeah.
And Nate played at her salons probably more than any other pianist.
Hmm.
1922 Steinway.
Yeah.
That she has. Wow. Still has, her brother still has it.
Mm.
Her brother and sister-in-law are here from Paris attending to her estate. Mm. And we will be having an ongoing series. We'll have more information for you, but it's going to be coming up next year, probably three salons at the Mamie Clayton Library starting April 6th.
Good news.
So stay tuned.
Stay tuned. Good news. Edith Bronston, the president of the California Jazz Foundation. Final words of wisdom that our viewers should know about the foundation. And again, I want you to reiterate this upcoming event in April.
Yes, April 6th is our big annual fundraiser. It's a gala. We're honoring Ruth Price this year. There'll be lots of publicity coming up very shortly. Mm-hmm. I would just like to remind you that any contributions, year-end contributions will also be matched by the Herb Alpert Foundation. We have a matching grant up to $10,000, so that's I forgot to mention that. That's very
that's
important.
Real important information, particularly given the fact that it's the Herb Alpert Foundation.
Yes. And just one other thing, please tell people that we exist, because so many musicians don't seem to know about us until it's really late, and we can always, we're here to help.
Mm.
That's what we do.
I'd also like to add that K-Jazz has been our media sponsor for several years now. Stephanie Levine Fried has been very gracious in promoting our cause.
Yes.
Wonderful. That's great. Great news. If you've been with us throughout, you know that I shared with you that we lost a great drummer and band leader in Chico Hamilton. What I'd like to do now is give you a few more insights about the late, great Forrest Orr and Chico Hamilton from L.A. and Jefferson High School. Some of you may not know that for the last several years prior to his passing, he was on the staff at the New School in New York City. In fact, he was a co-founder of the jazz program at the New School, and they put together this video that kind of told the story of Chico Hamilton and his tenure at the New School and the impact that he had on the jazz community. So let's watch that and we'll come back.
Can I?
Jazz is not a subject you just come in, you read the book and you learn it. Now I know how to play jazz. It takes years and it takes doing it. You know, and Chico has been doing it for many, many, many years.
Chico Hamilton's place in the program at the New School is special because he is one of the individuals who has written the performance history of jazz.
The hippest thing about the New School is the fact that all our instructors are pros, are professionals in their craft. It's what I do. I've never done anything else other than shine shoes as a kid. And as a kid shining shoes, I made enough money to buy my first set of drums. My first day of teaching, I realized that this could be some way for me to get something back to music, my craft. Because music had been, and is still, very good to me.
One of my favorite things in his class was listening to the stories about where he traveled, the people he played with, always amazing stories and very passionate about what he was doing, which created a very good environment for us to learn and to get inspiration to go on.
He wants them to learn how to play jazz and to swing and do it correctly. He could care less about this new theory and all of that stuff. You know, he wants them to learn how to snap their fingers when they play, you know.
That's it, everybody. Now here's the boogie-woogie, solid beat. Come on, you dancers, on your feet.
Joe Jones was the drummer with the Count Basie Orchestra. Joe Jones was my mentor. Joe Jones changed me completely. Not only me, he influenced just about every drummer that was on the scene at that time. We talked just about every day, but we never talked about drums. But I got a drum lesson every day in talking with him, talking about life.
Someone who is a great musician, who has spent time developing his or her voice, will be the kind of person who makes it easier for a student to understand the importance of discovering his or her own voice in their development. Chico Hamilton is one of those people.
Chico doesn't tell you how to play, really. He wants to see the real you come out.
Find your own personality in the music. In other words, we sort of frown on copycats.
Yeah. He just sets you free. You know, he doesn't tell you, you know, play C major here or F major there. He just blow, you know?
Do your own thing, play yourself. The music is you, you know, it's part of your personality. Yeah, Chico's like that.
He puts you at ease. You know, he just makes you realize that, all right, this is music, it's supposed to be fun, it's supposed to be relaxed. If you're not relaxed, then you can't play.
It's always been a melodic instrument to me. Don't know how to get a sound out of it. And I maintain a triad, 1-3-5 chord, do, da, de, right? As long as you get three different tones, that's it. You use your touch. You're joking with it.
The Chico Hamilton sound is this very unique, cool groove with in-tune musicians listening to each other, playing acoustically. And now on the top of all that, over all that, is this beautiful melody. A very simple, clear, easy to sing melody. Once he starts his tempo, it's like a heartbeat. It really, really swings, and it feels good.
But we happen to know I'm your star pupil, because I reflect back to you your own talent.
I'd hate to take a bite of you. You're a cookie full of arsenic.
Sweet Smells to Death. It was a good film.
Burt Lancaster, Tony Curtis, and the Chico Hamilton Quintet.
All of a sudden, I was in showbiz. I didn't know anything about showbiz before. And being in showbiz, your life changed. And I just started getting cooler. I was in England working with Lena Horne, me and my quartet. And I was doing a movie with Roman Polanski, which was Repulsion. So I spent all my days out on the set with Roman and the nights playing with Lena. He was the hippest director I've ever worked for. He never forgot why he hired me.
At the beginning of every class, every new semester, he doesn't say a word. He just sits there quietly, but before all the students walk in, he writes on the blackboard, "Leave egos outside!" Exclamation point.
Come on in. How you doing? 12 bar blues. Okay. Miss Piano, four counts. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, let it sustain. Just... Okay? You cool?
Yes.
Most of the students, they like him. Like him very much. And I do know he's strict, you know. I know that about him.
And if you miss it again, you're going to have to buy us all a drink.
So he will put you in place. Like, listen, this is the way it's done. Like, this is the way you have to think. So he wasn't just brushing it off and say, okay, next. You know, he made you do it. It was a lot of laughter in that class and smiling. And, like, I always come back to the openness and the good environment that he created. Just the... cool. He's cool.
What's given me the most satisfaction is just knowing that hanging out with him, you don't just learn about music, you learn about life.
I think he's an amazing musician and an awesome person. And I'm very thankful for everything that he taught us.
We've been friends for so long, it's hard for me to just define it down to one thing. You know? It's good when you can have a friend like that you don't have to think about. It's just natural.
Best friends.
Yeah.
Shit, man, that's good, man. What you say your name was, man?
No, I love him. I think he's a very special individual. And I'm very happy that he, for more than 20 years, has been able to give his heart and soul to so many younger musicians coming up. And he still plays his ass off.
A relatively brief profile of the late Chico Hamilton. This was produced back in 2009. So obviously they were talking in the present tense about all of the great contributions Chico Hamilton was making for that school. And unfortunately,
he got out of here, but he's making beautiful music up there, as I mentioned earlier, on that big bandstand in the sky. Before we go any further, I do want to take just a minute or two to thank some very special people, specifically people who've helped bring you this program, all this music and all of these video clips, and they make me look as good as one can make someone look. I want to acknowledge first and foremost the gentleman who heads up the distance learning program at Cal State Dominguez Hills, Dr. Warren Ashley. Thank you, Warren, as always, all the years that we've worked together. Your expertise is truly appreciated. To Calvin Coe, who's also on staff, he's done so much in taking a lot of the video clips and putting them together and doing some duplication work and being there to make certain that everything is in place. Thank you, Calvin. And these young people who will go on to bigger and better things, chances are, in this business of broadcasting, specifically Janiel Romero, who has been directing over the last several sessions. In fact, most of the sessions this semester were directed by Janiel. Thank you, Janiel, so much. Wonderful young woman who's graduating. We're losing her. She's graduating in the spring. To Sharon George, who does graphics. She sits at the computer and does the YouTube stuff. And many thank yous to Sharon. To Mr. Leroy Harden, who is a jack of all trades. He does graphics. He helps get the water. He makes us comfortable. He mics us and all that other good stuff that assists in making this program happen. And last but not least, to Mr. Van Bridgman, who's also on staff here, who is co-director of the Distance Learning Program. And I've worked with Van for many, many years. And Van continues to instruct young people, as does Warren Ashley, in the ins and outs of broadcasting. And I'm certain that the students have picked up a whole heck of a lot this semester. So thank you to all of you for helping to make this program a reality. And sure as shooting, we'll be back in the spring. So I'm really excited about that. Again, let me make that announcement. We will leave the air this evening. We'll return on Tuesday, January 21st at 9 p.m. for another 14 or so sessions of Jazz in the Modern Era. And my hope is that I can have people like the people who joined me this evening come down to Carson, California for some good music and some good times. My very special guest, Edith Bronston and Jeffrey Winston, thank you all so much.
Thank you, Chet.
Thank you so much. This
it's a fun
was
ride.
Wonderful.
Oh, it's always, man, always a pleasure. Jeff's been doing this with me for a number of years, and Edith, it's a pleasure to have you out. And,
well, it's a pleasure
and talk about
here.
That very important foundation, the California Jazz Foundation. And if you were with us a little earlier when Clint Rosemond, who joined me a few weeks ago, called and asked that you open up your wallet and donate to the California Jazz Foundation, because they make it happen for so many musicians in need. And there's the website on your screen. Go to it, check it out, get more information, and make the lives of these wonderful individuals even richer beyond the music, because the music they make is wonderful, but they are people too. They have needs that need to be met. Basic needs.
Yes.
I mean, when it gets down to just paying the rent, it doesn't get any more basic than that. Huh?
That's right.
Food and shelter.
Food and shelter. And Jeff, wow. We'll work on another theme for next semester. I'm sure we'll come up with some. We had a couple of hints tonight. It's been a blast. I'm gonna ask that you provide some final words, whatever comes to mind, and then we'll close things out with another look at one of your favorite musicians, as well as one of my favorites and Jeffrey's. Jeffrey, we'll go with you first.
Well, there is a project in the making. Things have not been completely finalized. But again, K-Jazz has proposed to do a major fundraiser for the World Stage on January 26th at the Nate Holden Performing Arts Center. The headliners, there'll be some heavy hitters that's being develop right now.
Okay.
So there'll be more to come.
The date again?
January 26th.
Do you offhand, you know the day of the week?
Not offhand.
Okay, January 26th.
Right.
That's the plan at this point in
exactly.
time. Exactly.
Okay, Nate Holden Center for Performing Arts.
Nate Holden on Washington Boulevard.
Right.
Or is it on Adams?
No, it's on Washington.
It's on Washington.
Right.
I'll get it
the
straight.
Old Ebony Showcase. And if you go to the website,
there's another session.
Okay. The old Metropolitan Theater, the after-hours scene that Jay Rich produced.
You mentioned the website?
Yeah, it's theworldstage.org. If you go there, you can get the update.
Great, great. And once again, Edith, I know you mentioned it twice, but again, California Jazz Foundation's upcoming gala.
Sunday, April 6th, honoring Ruth Price. Join us. And just as importantly, tell everybody you know that we're here to help and help us help our musicians.
Great.
Send money.
Wonderful.
Join us when we have our events and talk about us. Thanks.
Good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, yeah. Both of you.
Appreciate it.
Let me close things out by thanking all of you who've stayed with us for the 14 weeks in our fall semester. Again, I'll be returning in the spring. I'm overjoyed about that. In this semester, we haven't tried to cover the waterfront where jazz is concerned, but I have shared a lot of music, some from the 30s. We covered that transition from swing to bop, late 30s into the early 1940s, and subsequently transitioning into the cool period, the hard bop period, the modal period, the fusion period. Didn't get a lot into fusion this particular semester. We have in past semesters. And maybe next semester we'll explore that whole fusion movement a little more in depth, because a lot of controversy that connects with the fusion movement in jazz, but that's for another time. I've tried to feature artists both in the past and those who continue to make music as we speak, and it's been a joy for me to have that opportunity. Have a great holiday. We're going to close things out with another look at the immortal Charlie Parker. Like so many jazz musicians, they always wanted to do a date with strings. Charlie Parker was successful in that endeavor. So we're going to close our semester out with Charlie Parker and strings, the tune April in Paris. Have a great rest of the week. We'll see you next semester. Thank you for tuning in.